आनंदाचे वखल विमानि भूतानि जायन्ते आनंदेन जातानि जीवन्ति आनंदं प्रयन्ति अभिसंविशन्तीति सैषा भार्गवी वारुणी विद्या परमे व्योमं प्रतिष्ठिता य एवं वेद प्रतिष्ठति अन्नवानन्नादो भवति महान् भवति प्रजया पशुभिर्ब्रह्मवर्चसेन महान् कीर्त्या हरिः ओम्
ಗುರುಭ್ಯೋ ನಮಃ. ಗುಡ್ ಆಫ್ಟರ್ನೂನ್. ಮೇ ಐ ರಿಕ್ವೆಸ್ಟ್ ಅವರ್ ಡೀನ್ ಅಂಡ್ ಡೈರೆಕ್ಟರ್ ಡಾಕ್ಟರ್ ಮಿಸಸ್ ವೈಜಿಪಿ, ಅವರ್ ಡೆಪ್ಯೂಟಿ ಡೀನ್ ಅಂಡ್ ಡೈರೆಕ್ಟರ್ ಟು ಲೀಡ್ ಅವರ್ ಗೆಸ್ಟ್ ಆಫ್ ದ ಆಫ್ಟರ್ನೂನ್ ಮಿಸ್ಟರ್ ಎನ್ ವೆಂಕಟರಾಮನ್, ಸೀನಿಯರ್ ಅಡ್ವೊಕೇಟ್ ಸುಪ್ರೀಂ ಕೋರ್ಟ್ ಆಫ್ ಇಂಡಿಯಾ ಟು ದ ಡೇಸ್. I request principals of Nungambakkam School, KK Nagar and Siriseri, Mrs. Vasanti, Mrs. Geeta Govindarajan and Mrs. Vijayalakshmi Raman to occupy their seats on the stage. Prayer is our greatest wireless connection with the Supreme. Let's begin our Diamond Jubilee celebration special lecture on Acharya Dharma for the 21st century learner with an invocation.
ಸಧಾ ಜನ Bharma Bhushana Bhushite Vararatna Muli Virajite Sharmadayini Karma Mochani Nirmalam Kurumana Samusharde Karuna Nidhe. Hasta sandrita pustaka kshapadi sudagata mudrike Hasta sandrita pustaka kshapadi sudagata mudrike Kashtavasti hi kavarnane chaduro naraka charota vasharde karuna nide sagalana vambasadha janan sharanadimagita vaye bhavapur tagiradhikdate sharde karuna nide
Thank you, students, for the mellifluous start. The most valuable resource that all teachers have is each other. Without collaboration, our growth is limited to our own perspectives. On that note, I invite Mrs. Vasanti, Principal, Nungambakkam School, to formally welcome the erudite gathering.
Thank you, Mrs. Malti. Yatho dharmas tatho jayaha. Where there is dharma, there is victory, said Gandhari to her son Duryodhana when he sought her blessings on the eve of the Kurukshetra battle. Interestingly, these words also constitute the motto of the highest judicial forum of our country. And we are very fortunate to have with us today leading advocate, Supreme Court of India, Mr. N. Venkataraman. And he is here to address us on the topic, Acharya Dharma for the 21st century. It is my pleasant duty, sir, to welcome you on behalf of the PSBB Group of Schools. Shri Gurubhyo Namaha, and a very pleasant evening to everyone present. Hearty welcome to the Diamond Jubilee Special Lecture. It is said that if we are sitting in the shade today, it is because someone planted a tree long ago. 60 years ago, this institution started as a small seed on the terrace of a modest building. It has now grown and spread its branches all over the city and even beyond due to the dream, the vision, the drive, and the passion of the legend who is amidst us today, Dr. Mrs. YGP, founder, Dean and Director, PSBB Group of Schools. It is my privilege to welcome you, ma'am. Keeping in line with the Diamond Jubilee theme, rededicating a glorious past to a radiant future, a gamut of meaningful activities have been carefully planned, curated, and executed by our top management. It is my pleasure to extend a gracious welcome to them, Mrs. Sheila Rajendra, our Deputy Dean and Director and Correspondent, and Mr. YG Rajendra, Executive Trustee, PSBB Group of Schools. A very special welcome to the heads of the schools and all the special invitees who have taken time to be with us today. I take this opportunity to extend a hearty welcome to all the teachers who chisel and shape the lives of young minds and who work hard to bring out the best in them. 3 hours of invigilation, last day of term, bundles of papers waiting to be corrected, yet enthusiastic and ever receptive to new ideas and learning. These are the hallmarks of the teachers of PSBB. I'm very happy and proud to welcome you all to this special lecture on Acharya Dharma for the 21st century. A very hearty welcome to one and all once again. Thank you so much. I now request Mrs. Vijayalakshmi Raman, Principal, PSBB Sirisery, to formally introduce our guest for today. Thank you.
Thank you, Mrs. Vasanti. Sri Gurubhyo Namaha and a good evening. On behalf of the PSBB group of schools, I deem it an honor to introduce an illustrious personality, an eminent speaker, and an embodiment of justice to this august gathering. With Christmas Eve in about 24 hours from now, let me begin on a lighter note with Santa Claus. Santa Claus, the tooth fairy, an honest lawyer, and a drunk, spot a 500 rupee note on the floor. Who do you think gets it? The drunk, because the other three are imaginary characters. But here amongst us is the most honest of lawyers to prove a fact that honest lawyers are not fantasy beings. It is a matter of pride that a South Indian advocate occupies the hallowed seat at the Supreme Court. Mr. Venkataraman owes his professional success to his mentor, Shri C. Natarajan, senior advocate. He humbly dedicates his very existence to his spiritual guru, His Holiness Shri Shri Bharati Tirtha Mahaswamigal of Shri Sharada Peetam Sringeri. With his guru's blessings, he runs a Veda Patashala in his maternal village at Mel Mangalam near Theni. His fair and just approach has made him contribute to his paternal village too. He has constructed a temple for Goddess Bala Tripura Sundari in Kodimangalam, his father's village. It is this deep-rooted, unflinching faith in the divine that has enabled him imbibe all the essential values that befit a conscientious lawyer. Mr. Venkataraman has completed 27 years of dedicated service in the fields of indirect taxation, direct taxation, international taxation, and other regulatory laws. His persuasive skills have come in handy to streamline the standards of jurisprudence in the two evolving areas of transfer pricing and international taxation. He has been closely associated in voicing the issues concerning the trade before the central government for appropriate amendments and clarifications. Post demonetization, all of us are aware of the carcinogenic effect of black money. Here is a crusader who has done extensive research on issues pertaining to black money. He wields his pen to express his views through articles on black money that throw ample light on this evil practice. His blessed tongue has argued cases that have been adjudged as the best case of the year by International Tax Review. Most of these cases he appeared for have been reported widely. His recent victory was when he won an important milestone judgment before the Supreme Court for the construction industry, both under VAT and service tax. Saman seidhu seerthookum kolpol amaindhu urupal kodamai sandrorku ani. Besides following Thiruvalluvar's dharma of naduva nilamai, he is committed to our sanatana dharma in thoughts, words and deeds. Recently, he has written a commentary on Lalita Sahasranamam in English, which will be shortly uploaded on the web. May I request our Dean and Director, Dr. Mrs. YGP, and our Deputy Dean and Director and Correspondent to honor this Dharma Adhikari with a memento and a bouquet as a token of our gratitude. Thank you, ma'am. I now call upon Mr. Venkataraman to deliver the Diamond Jubilee special lecture on Acharya Dharma for the 21st century.
Om Shri Gurubhyo Namaha. Mala Sudakumbha Vibhoda Mudram Vidya Virajat Karavari Jatam Aparakarunya Sudamburasim Shri Sharadambam Pranatosmi Nityam Agyanam Jannavi Tihirtam Vidya Tihirtam Vivekinam Sarvesham Shukatam Tihirtam Bharati Tihirtam Ashyage Vidya Vinaya Sampannam Vitarakam Vivekinam வந்தே வேதாந்த தத்வஜம் விதுஷேகர பாரதி குருத்சாட்சாத் பரபிரம்மம் தஸ்மை ஸ்ரீ குரவே நமஹ. I offer my humble pranams to every teacher here and seek your blessings before I proceed to share few of my thoughts on the designated topic today. For any speaker to be associated, and that too during the Golden Jubilee year celebration as part of it, has to be a moment of pride to be part of this PSBB institution, at least as a speaker. I carry that pride in my heart and the joy, and with utmost reverence and respect to each one of you, I shall try to share a few of my thoughts. We have the iconic figure present on the stage, Dr. Mrs. YGP, 6.5 decades of untiring, relentless, exerting journey in the field of education. The time given to me is about close to an hour, and both education and dharma are two huge topics. So what I thought, the first few minutes, let me identify the areas which I don't want to touch today. Let's be very clear about that, so that we will narrow down to one or two clear aspects, a possibility as to what we can possibly integrate within the framework and try to do our best to the children. And that should possibly suffice this 1 hour. So the topic, first few minutes, let's identify the areas and say that these are not areas not for today's discussion. When you talk of education, an institution and the teaching community is caught between the educational policy to be framed by the government and the people who actually recruit students who qualify and graduate from schools and colleges later. So you are actually jinxed between these two forces, and you have absolutely no control over them. We can't, because unlike some countries where education is either semi-control or no control, India education is completely controlled. Even last week in a Delhi High Court, there was a huge writ petition. Somebody has started an institution, there are 5,000 children reading, and he has applied the recognition, and because of political reasons, recognition is not given. And the only point the council is arguing before the court is 5,000 families are trusting me. What more do I need to show that I am a good educator? But the court is not willing to go by that, because court has its own theme by going by the rule of law. So you have educational policies governed by so many other factors at one end. And the other end is, whatever we may say in improving the quality of education, value-based, whatever perspective we may think of, ultimately the person who wants to appoint goes by qualification, goes by marks, goes by XYZ concepts. So you are left with no option. So that's not something which we can discuss here, nor can we influence the government in 1 hour to think or radically a different view. So I'm not going to talk on that. Now come to the next stage. In fact, Sheila Rajendran was extremely helpful in preparing this talk. I've been in constant touch with her for close to 20 days, almost an hour a day, as to how we can go about this. And she sent me a lot of material on the Finland type of education. I don't think we can replicate it so easily in India for ever so many reasons. But what we can possibly think of today as a value add, which you might have already been doing, education some years back was actually teaching and preaching. Today, education is more a supportive and assistance role. That looks to be a huge U-turn in the concept of education. So, can we use an institution like PSBB, where it may not be a constraint, can we integrate and use more and more of technical applications and methods, and the teacher can only be a guide, rather than consuming 35 or 40 minutes the whole time in running a class and running a schedule, which otherwise the boy or the girl, interested or not interested, can always download from the web and find out what this course content is. So this is something which possibly we can learn from the advancement of technology and the development that takes place. And this is one area, again, I think it's not for us to decide how to go about it, because the topic which I want to touch upon doesn't delineate on this. So I don't want to speak about this too. Then why have you come here is the question that may run in your mind. Last working day, all ready to celebrate a holiday for the next 10 days. And oh no, I have withheld you. I'm going to withhold you for a couple of hours and your holidays are getting delayed. But never mind, I'll assure you some take home at the end of the day. So what do we want to cover today? I think we can deal with three buckets, at least one of them in detail, and the other two to the extent possible. And why I've structured these three buckets for discussion today is, there is a reasonable hope, at least from my perception, of course after discussing with a few educators, the thoughts which we are likely to share in the next few minutes, you don't have to do the somersault of ignoring the existing syllabus. You don't have to be moving away 360 degree to inculcate this, to ensure that, to see that is there a conflict between the educational stream that is happening and what we are trying to integrate. These three themes are something which you can possibly plan whenever you can. Few minutes a day, few minutes a week with children, and see whether you can impact them to the extent possible so that they mold themselves as better children and better citizens tomorrow. The basic distinction I draw between the academic education and what we are likely to discuss in the next few minutes is, academic education is acquisition of knowledge. There's a set of syllabus, there's a standard procedure of teaching, there's a standard procedure of assessment. But building a personality is something you form a character, you form a personality, you create a human being in a child. That is not acquisition of knowledge. So those tools won't work. And we need not resort to those tools. Now, what are the three buckets which I thought I should refer to here? Faith in God is one huge bucket, because it's becoming a challenging issue. Second is the need to preserve family institutions, which is the core philosophy of an Indian culture. When the rest of the world gives primacy to individuals, we give primacy to family institutions, and that's slowly dying. So that's the second area. And of course, the third area is the value-based education. These are the three which, as teachers, over a period of 10 or 12 or 15 years, when the child travels with you from the pre-kindergarten till the 12th standard, you can constantly impact the child without having to disturb his equations in getting the marks in chemistry and working out a 200 out of 200 in as many subjects as possible to gain entry into a college of his choice. Now, broadly speaking, what do we mean by these three? I'll touch on the first two, faith in God and family, very, very mildly, because I want to concentrate on the third, which according to me is most important for today's talk. We need to identify the area so that there is clarity. Just don't believe people who says that there is no God. It has been, such a thought has been defeated multiple times in millions of years, in millions of ways. And it can be proved in 2017, somebody cannot stand up and disprove that there is no God. It's not possible. When birth is not under your control, when death is not under your control, it's absurd to presume living an existence is under your control. Absolute myth. All the three have to sync together, and that makes life. And therefore, to say that existence is purely in my hands and there's nothing called destiny just won't work. I'll just cite you one example. Every day you see so many debates and so many lectures and so many notes exchanged, WhatsApp messages on contesting the existence and the non-existence of God. More concrete questions, more penetrative, more philosophical issues have been raised in the past by very great thinkers contesting the existence of God. There is a school of thought called Charuvakyas who says, what do you mean by this body and life? Why do you get into the myth of a karma, previous birth, future birth? Nonsense. How does this body come? Take the case of a betel leaf, which is green in color. The betel nut, which is brown in color. And the additive, which is white or rose in color. You bind all the three together and chew it in your mouth, you get a red color. This red color is not traceable to the green betel leaf, nor the brown betel nut, nor the additive which is white or rose. This human body is just like that. It just comes from the Panchabhutas and it gets dissolved. There is no antecedent to it and there is no subsequent birth. Just don't believe. Things like this have been argued in the past and lost. So the philosophers who believed in God asked only one question to them. Fine, you're citing an example of the change in color that happens chewing in your tongue, in your mouth. But what we want to know is, why is something a betel leaf? Why is something a betel nut? Who creates it? Why should somebody? World can be only have betel leaves. World can only have betel nuts if it's, that's your choice. It's your prerogative. If it's your option, which your discretion you can exercise. So you are talking of the output or the consequences of it. You don't trace it to the source. Each one is a different product. Who creates it? No answer. So faith in God, we believe everything happens because of the grace of God. Million times we can emphasize on that fact. And whoever wish to contest, if they are logical, we can get to engage into a debate and then persuade them. But if they are illogical, we'll just avoid them, overlook them. We don't have to change our views to suit their needs. So children must have an exposure to this territory. Now come to the institution of family. Last week, when I was flying down from Delhi to Chennai, a beautiful couple, one should be 77 year old man, and the lady should be almost touching 70, both sitting together, relaxing. So the air hostess goes to them and says, what should I serve it you, sir? The man triumphantly smiles, my lady decides for me. And the air hostess looks at the lady. She beams so happily because the choice is given to her, because it's she who has to decide what both of them have to eat. Then she dishes the menu card and she recommends, this cake is a fine cake, very fresh, very nice to eat. And she was giving a huge sermon on why they should both take that cake. After listening for a few minutes, the lady said, all right, I do like cakes, but my husband doesn't take it, so I don't want to eat it. Then the air hostess flicks her eyes to the man. Yes, I don't take cakes, the man says. Then they share something which is given to them. Then after 20 minutes, he opens the overhead locker, removes a computer, and takes two sets of earphones. See, it's not one set of earphones, one sharing, and one begging to through the... So two sets of earphones, one for her and one for him. And the best of Hindi duet film songs, they were dancing in joy. How does this happen? 40 or 45 years of matrimony and a man and a woman living together. And the readiness and the psychological happiness in one leaning over the other. This is the strength of an Indian value system. My classmate celebrated her birthday 10 days back. As usual, in our busy schedule, we called her at around 9:30, 10 in the night to greet her and a happy birthday. Then curiosity, I asked her, what was your schedule? She said, it started yesterday at night, 12 o'clock exactly, and it's still continuing, may end up by 12 today. And I asked her, how many greeted you? Some 500, 600 people in Facebook, some 200 or 300 in WhatsApp, and 50 or 60 over telephone, and 5 or 10 over personal greetings, totaling to 700, 800 numbers. I asked her, out of this, which moment do you find it as the most pleasant and memorable? She did not even hesitate for a minute. She said, I wish to only carry with me and preserve with me and cherish two great moments. Exactly at the stroke of 12, midnight, my two sons, one living with me and the other guy living in Bombay, joined on a call and they brought a cake and all the three of us celebrated the birthday at 12 o'clock. That was one great moment which I will mark as my pleasant moment, birthday moment. And I said, what's the second? I was waiting and with an element of fear, when 900 fellows are greeting me, my husband should not fail to greet me. Unfortunately, he did not disappoint me. At 11 o'clock in the morning, he called me without my reminding that it was my birthday. So, when he greeted me, well, I was flying high in life. Nothing else mattered to me. I think this will be the feeling every woman, Indian woman, will be reflecting and replicating in her thought process. I don't think an Indian woman can think differently than this. And I'll cite the third example. Somebody got married recently and she is moving away from her house to the in-law's house. Morning, 8:30, getting ready to go. As she was preparing to go, the servant maid in the family, who has been working with them for close to 20 years, she said, Dupare, I want to talk to you for 5 minutes. So all of, whoever assembled there was watching her with a lot of curiosity. What's she going to say? And she dictated three sermons, unforgettable. The first one she declared is, remember, you are used to a particular lifestyle all these years for 25 years. You have been pampered, you have been cared, you have been nurtured. But when you go to a new place, remember that place has to be different. It can't be the same. Therefore, register this difference in your mind. It can't be the same. Even though, surprisingly, it is the same. That's a different story. But her thought process. And the second sermon she declared was, don't try to change anybody in that house. If you can change yourself, try to do it. Or if you want to change them, the process has to be very slow. Don't try to create an impact overnight. It's not good. And the third, ensure you don't shout standing on the rooftop as you normally do it with your mother. And she said, if this is fine, you will have a wonderful married life, all the best. A servant maid. This is India. This is this Indian soil. She need not be illiterate to know all this. It's part of our genetics. And now what people want to know, they want to throw away this family life. Get rid of this family life. The husband on a Sunday works on his files. The wife on a Sunday, as she cooks, is engaged in WhatsApp with her group, close-knit, all. The son and the daughter sitting in two different rooms. One is on a phone, another is on a laptop, and they are all spending their Sunday under the same roof together. So this is the defining moment. So this is something which we need to impart to a child, the importance of family institution, especially to girls. If we educate a girl, then we educate a society. Because a girl is the direct, See, I starting from Ramayana days, women have been respected. We are a civilized society, and says if you allow a woman to cry, it's a road for ruin. That's what our scriptures and epics have taught us. Unless you please your woman, you're not going to be happy in life. It's a fact. It's a fact. And we should do that. And that's a... See, when somebody in an interview gave a beautiful answer, what is that intimacy of a husband and wife? How do we explain it? And the girl, and the lady, fortunately not a feminist, gave a beautiful and a brilliant answer. She said, whenever I stop to think that I need my man around for this, and I lift my head, I find my man ready to receive me there. That's the family life. That's exactly is love between a husband and wife. So this is the essence of family institution. Why should we allow it to get buried by this so-called people who put primacy to individuals and not to the institutions? So this is the second important bucket. And the third is value-based education. I've taken 20 minutes on the first two. I'll take a few more minutes on the last, because that's the thrust for today. Each one can be dealt at length, but we will deal with what you mean by, what do you actually mean? What is the process of this value-based education which each one of you can impart on your child without having to disturb the educational syllabus and the system? Let's define the output of value-based education. Let's define there. Unless you define the output, see, modern thinkers design it only that way. We don't look at the effect, we only look at the cause. But modern world wants the effect to be first reflected and then go into the cause. We'll do the same exercise, no problem. What should be the output which we are trying to do through this value-based education? The output has to be nobility and humility in a child. I think the whole world can be bundled if somebody is noble and somebody is humble. Read the entire history, any part of the world. People who have achieved high have remained very noble and very, very humble. So, this is the quintessence which we should impart in our child. Make them understand getting marks, putting them on a tough course, taking them on them for not scoring what they need. It's all a different story. That's all 2020 matches. We are talking of building a huge lineage, a huge life for them. So make them understand they can be happy in life only if they remain noble and humble in life. Now, having defined the output, who are the participants to do this job? There are four characters in it. The institution, the teacher, the parent, and the student. You can't have a combination of only parent and teacher and student. We will get rid of those parents who are insisting on that. We don't have to be worried about them. We should not lose our focus. Merely because 10 people are distracting us, we should not fall into prey to their trap. We should pursue on people who are ready to join us. Unless all the four unite together, you can't bring the child as noble child or a child who is very humble. If a parent thinks that I have paid, I have outsourced, and therefore I have dumped them in an institution, it is they should bring their end product, we can't join issue with them. Very simple. I'll give only two examples for that. Each one is influenced by something in life. When we were all children, we watched Raman and Sagar's Ramayana and Krishna, and that molded our lives. Then, as a replication, recently, Ekta Kapoor's Meendum Mahabharatam is something which has cast a great influence in my life, and I keep telling them to as many people as possible. It is in Tamil, it's in various languages, 269 episodes. The way the serial is constructed is very important. A, they bring out a character called Krishna who appears very frequently in every episode or more episodes and tries to discuss concepts of life. They will take a theme, he will associate it with the surrounding circumstances and deliver a message. Outstanding. Each one is so well planned. The second most important is, because we'll all apply logical thinking, we don't want to follow somebody like a sheep, all that is taught to us now. Unless you have faith in your guru and follow like a sheep, nothing will transform to you, is what our philosophy says. Never mind. Now what do they say in this? Krishna always puts a question to the opposite character. Defines the situation, defines the question, and then draws the answer. For example, in the battlefield, all we know, Bhagavad Gita was profusely preached to Arjuna and through Arjuna to the world. Krishna puts three options to Arjuna. Option one, with extreme joy, with extreme aggression, you fight the war and you lose. What will happen to you? You will get frustrated. You will get disappointed and you will start turning hostile. And therefore, you will start committing papas. Second option, you wage the war with the same joy and same aggression and you succeed in the war. Then it will get into your head, it will bloat your ahankara, you will become more egoistic and you will replace Duryodhana and become more tyrannical. Now the third plan, plan C, you wage the war as you have to perform a duty to restore Dharma. So he says, it's not the action that matters. How you associate your mind to that action. You do it with exuberance and then you'll face the consequences of papa or punya. Whereas remove that exuberance and do it as a duty. You will get my support and you will establish or restore or re-establish Dharma. I think that's the request I think the institution and all of us should make to each one of you. See, when we read so much about Finland, the kind of veneration and adoration teachers carry in that country is something I think 100 years back India should have done that. Now, there is a general feeling by all of you that you have been put down by the society, naturally, in terms of several reasons. Now, therefore, there is an anxiety as to why we should do all this. There is a pressure exerted by the parents, which we have not done. Our parents have not done. They have never visited a school. There is nothing called a parents teaching meeting at all in my school. One of the leading schools. In fact, Shobhana Ramchand wanted to come here, TVS school. She should have been present here. She fell sick and she gave me a call saying she's not traveling today. She wanted to be part of it. She believes in the same way what Madam and Sheila Rajendran believes in value-based education. She wanted to be part of this course today. Now, the respect, we left it to the school and whatever the teacher says, the parent will also follow. Now, parents are questioning a lot of things. They engage in controversial issues with the teacher and the institution. So, in this scenario, do we have the motivation? That's the question. Therefore, I'm requesting you, forget everything around you. You are blessed with one thing. God has blessed you an opportunity to shape the future and destiny of few children, and through that society, and through that the nation. Please think of that. It's an opportunity which everyone else is missing. Therefore, please think of that opportunity. And what Krishna says, if you work your plan C, if you do it as a duty, then I will support you. You will get the reward which will be so unique. See, remember, God is the most compassionate amongst creation. If somebody has to be avyaja karuna murti, we say in Lalita Sahasranam and put an archane mechanically. Avyaja karuna, ocean of compassion is God. Have that faith. So, if you do it as a duty, because you are given that role in this birth, you are chosen vehicles to preach, to impart, to nurture and bring the best out of a child. How many will get this opportunity? And therefore, this is exactly what a teacher's role in this value-based education. Coming to the parents, I think we should speak with parents some other time. Krishna again says, in yet another context, makes it very clear, with modern relevance. He says, if a parent thinks he can create wealth for his child, fat bank balance accounts, the best of luxury, the best of education, the best of society, strata in the society, but zero value, those children simply will not know how to sustain, nurture and maintain what is handed over to them. Forget everything else. They simply won't know how to carry forward. Somebody puts a question in a PTA meeting. You are talking about value-based. When somebody was really persuading parents to be part of it, look here, if I get marks, I have to pay only 2.5 lakhs in engineering college. If I don't get marks, I'll have to fund 25 lakhs. Who is going to fund the deficit? This is a question a parent puts it. And she is such a very smart lady. Gave it back. All right, you decide whether it's 2.5 or 25 lakhs, but be prepared to be in the old age asylum at some point of time. That's the answer. It's a package. What you sow, so you reap. So, a parent has to be cooperative. And he says, if you're going to do all this, you are actually trading with your own children. It's not different from trading with the rest of the world. Have you imparted values to your children? Krishna says it very clearly. Because you are the upbringing, the growth, prospect, prosperity, happiness of your children is based on their karmas. You can't be substituting or playing into their karmas beyond a point. Their karmas have to be worked out by them. But what you need to therefore give is the chain, the baton. You need to transform the baton of your traditions, your values and your systems. Give that to them. Then leave the rest to me. I know how to take care of my children. It's not your business. Therefore, the role of a parent is equally important in value education. Parent cannot say, it's a full-time job for a parent. Whether you're a homemaker or you're a busy executive of a company, you still have to care for your child. That's an important aspect in growth. Now, if you do this, once you assemble the participants, these four fall into line. The institution, the teacher, the cooperative parent, and a cooperative child. Both are rarity now, no doubt. Let's take this message very clearly. See, we are not avatar purushas. There we can transform the whole world like a magic wand. Tomorrow everybody becomes great citizens. It's not possible. Let's be realistic. Let's start with small numbers and small quantities. And they in turn will impact. If five children find one child to be different, then there is a tendency to follow the child. Simple. It does something, it achieves something, and therefore we should also follow that. So concentrate on that seed. As the principal was introducing us, and more importantly introducing to all of us once again, Dr. YGP, what is important is the seed. A small plant, the size of the seed is same. For a banyan tree, the size of the seed is same. But one turns out to be a banyan. One turns out to be a plant which can be crushed on somebody's foot. Seed size is the same, but the potentiality which a seed can have is different from a banyan tree and from a non-ordinary bush. This institution, that way, is a banyan tree. See the kind of expansion it has gone for 60 years across the city. And to see a few of us asked one question. All of them assembled here, are they teachers or parents or a combination of outsiders also? We're surprised with the answer. All of them are teachers. Kind of so many teachers in one place. Amazing. It's a sight to watch. So this institution can attempt at this. A cooperation by the institution is support, institutional support, you get it. Teachers are grouted to think on these lines. Parents, whoever is ready, let's try to align. Once these three happens, the student has to follow suit. Now, what can you do to them? They say, come what may, you put it in the best of English words, you put it in the most diluted form, the most concentrated form. Nobility and humility is achieved only when you practice satyam and dharmam. Very simple. These are the two pillars on which the concept of nobility and humility rests. Somebody who doesn't nurture dharma can't be noble. Now, how do you get into the concept of preaching satyam and preaching dharma? That's the next stage. Now, Krishna teaches us the technique. A conversation happens, interestingly, in that episode which I was telling about, Meendum Mahabharatam. It may not be there exactly in the same way in the epic, but it's so nice and impressive for a modern thinker. Krishna summons Draupadi one day, just before the war, and tells her, look here, war is inevitable. And I tell you the consequences of this war. Because the final call has to be taken only by you, not by the Pandavas or the Kauravas. Because they have dishonored you, and the whole thing has pitched post this dishonor. So you will decide whether we should wage war or not wage war. I give you that liberty. And says the consequences. Look here, Draupadi. This war is fought for restoration of dharma and nothing else. But the price you need to pay for restoration of dharma is very huge. Except your five husbands, the entire Pandava race, all your children are going to get killed in this battle. So as a mother, now you have two roles, two hats to wear. You have to take a call as a Chakravartini. What should I do in the interest of the society? Or else you be just a mother and take a call what you should think of your five children. You decide and then tell me. Draupadi buys a day's time in that serial. and comes back. They meet the same time next day. And she tells Krishna, I'm very confused. So I don't want to take a call. Why don't you decide for me? You have been my friend, guide, philosopher, everything to me, and therefore I'll go by your guidance. Krishna said, that's good sense has prevailed ultimately in you. Thank God. I'll now tell you what you need to do. And in that process, tells each one of us what we should learn as value-based education, the core. And puts five important ingredients. If somebody has learned that, then they have learned what is value-based education. Krishna says, there are five organs or five indriyas or tools which play a major role in whatever we do. The heart, the mind, the buddhi, the body, and finally the soul or the atma. These are the five. Of course, atma doesn't play any role, it's a witness. Rest of the four activate themselves. Now Krishna says, the first step is learn to love through your heart and not through your buddhi. That's the first caution he utters. You must show love one and only from your heart. If you start showing love from buddhi, you will become selfish, and selfishness is a road to ruin. So the child should be made to understand God has given us a heart to love. He comes to the next, mind, and tells, mind should be used to build courage, not multiply desires. Keep on telling the child, God has given you a mind to be very, very courageous in life. Face situations, come what may. Then comes to buddhi and says, use the buddhi to acquire knowledge. You can't use heart or mind to acquire knowledge. Then you become emotional, you become impulsive, you become instinctive, and therefore you will be irrational. What you should use to do what? This combination is value-based education. All of us do all the five, but how do we combine is the question. So he says, use your buddhi to acquire knowledge. So the child should be nurtured in a way that when it is trying to acquire some knowledge out of something, it should have the power to reason, power to understand, power to comprehend, and say, this is exactly what using her or his buddhi. And then comes to the most important ingredient, fourth ingredient, the body. He says, Draupadi, you must use the first three, the heart, the mind, and the buddhi, along with the body, and offer it as a samarpanam. The expression he uses is samarpana buddhi. Now, and he develops this concept. I think that's the core of value-based education. What do you mean by samarpana buddhi? He explains it in three episodes, not in just one episode. He explains it in three episodes and in three phases. The first phase, he says, is the disconnect between a teacher and a student happens because of the following factors. This dialogue is happening in the backdrop of the Ekalevan situation. Then he takes that example and preaches this moral, saying that how does a disconnect happen between a teacher and a student? Three reasons. Laziness or distraction by the child.
or by the teacher. Don't mistake me. Not you. Could be somewhere else. Two. One is this laziness. The second thing is the child falling into an unnecessary comparison trap and starting feeling very jealous. This is the second dissuading pointer in a child's mind from being close to the teacher. It moves away from the teacher, either out of laziness or distraction, or out of jealousy over other students. Or the third reason he reasons it out is when the teacher scolds the student for some reason or the other, it develops a prejudice against the teacher without knowing that the teacher has done it for his good or her good. It develops the moment a teacher, and today I understand if you wink or if you see slightly hardly, then the whole gang lands into your for questioning and tough days, take rule of law into your hand, this is what will happen. Tough days. What can we teach in such a situation? So, these are the three aspects which distracts a child from aligning himself or herself with his teacher. He puts it out in the first episode. And he says, because of this non-alignment, the child loses the benefit of a transformation of knowledge from the guru to the sishya. See, there are two things in the spectrum of education. One is the acquisition spectrum. Teaching chemistry, teaching maths, teaching English, teaching poetry. Either you can teach or the computer will teach. Doesn't matter now today. But the second stream is nurturing and formation. One is acquisition, another is formation. Formation cannot be done by computers. It has to be done only by us, either as parents, or as students, or as teachers, or as an institution. So that's why I chose to confine my talk today only to formation. So when it comes to formation, Krishna says these three things allow a child to move away from the teacher. So who should now align with the student? You expect the student to come, or you should go to the student? It is preferable the teacher goes to the student. Better. In fact, recently, sometimes you also get good messages in WhatsApp. I saw a very, very interesting share. A question is asked by a teacher in Tamil Ilakkanam. And the fellow has replied, "My sister got married during this exam. I did not read. I basically don't like Tamil Ilakkanam. I am shocked these questions are asked to me. I have scored otherwise very good marks in rest of the subjects. I would appeal to you to condone my lack of knowledge in this Ilakkanam, and I would request you to understand my plight and be very merciful." This was the answer. And the marks given by the teacher is 5 out of 5. In that scenario, may not happen in reality. But the teacher has connected with the student. Never mind. What is important is, you had an option to allow the student to move further away or bring the student to you. She chose to bring the student to her, and therefore she said, "I will pardon you 5 out of 5. Rest of his life, the student will remain a student to that teacher for this act of or gesture of kindness. Children also measure kindness in their own way. They also have barometers. They also have yardstick to connect what they need to do with their teachers. So, this is the first stage, he says. Now, the second stage, he brings to the next stage of samarpana buddhi. What do you mean by samarpana buddhi? He gives two options there. Keep on worshipping the teacher and eulogizing the teacher as somebody who is a devata, who is a god, who is everything, but do nothing. Remain dull, remain inactive, remain non-cooperative, but do puja to teacher. This is one category. The second category is understanding what the teacher wants. and aligning themselves to the teacher's needs and then perform it. Krishna puts it, this is the second stage of Samarpana Buddhi. The first three stages are points of disconnect. Once you connect, then you get into the second phase. An option is given to the student to do this or that. The teacher should slowly inspire in the student's mind that coming close to her, speaking high about her, introducing suddenly see in a marriage or in a cinema theater, then you start praising the teacher in front of 20 people, but not do anything. Still not good. Teacher is not going to feel happy beyond a point. So, this is the second stage, he says. Now he comes to the last stage of Samarpana Buddhi. Finally concludes to say, if you take this route of aligning yourself, see, what do you mean by Samarpana Buddhi? You have this light, you have a switch, and you have a wire connecting it, and you have the energy passing through it. You don't allow energy to pass. You have the switch, you have the light, and you have the wire. It's still not going to glow. You have the energy, but you don't have the switch or the light, it will still not glow. So energy is the teacher's ability to impart. And this light and switch is nothing but the infrastructure, the capacity a student has. So a fusion of this together, there must be a sync, a complete trust. I think value-based education, the core philosophy of a value-based education is reposing trust in a teacher and the teacher reposing trust on his or her student. You don't have to worry about your syllabus there. Don't worry. Reposing trust is something which you can do from wherever you can. See, whatever I have been talking for the last 30, 40 minutes, you can't plead the limitation of time constraint, syllabus constraint, exam constraint, mark constraint, no constraint. All this you can do whenever you want to do with your child. That's value-based education. Now he says, goes to the third stage. What will be the output if you nurture the way Krishna wants to? He says, world produces two sets of performers. You find 60%, 70% of students performing very well in society. In institution like this, from where students dish out, 80%, 90% will be performing all over the world. You will find your students doing well. But Krishna says, that's fine. But what do you mean by that performance and success? They will perform and they will succeed only to that extent till such time somebody else overtakes them and substitutes them. He will be there till he is replaced. It's like a garment department. You are there in that seat till the age of 58 or 60. Once you retire, somebody else comes and sits, you become powerless next day. The same, you go into the same building, you look like a rank outsider. Till yesterday, you were wielding power sitting on the chair. Today, somebody is sitting on the chair. You go as a visitor, you are ignored. So this happens in the first category. When you don't follow Samarpana Buddhi, because you will ask me, what are you talking? 80% are successful and 90% are not having any Buddhi or Samarpana Buddhi. What are you teaching me? No, they will be successful. But they will always be under constant threat and fear and insecurity and lack of confidence in spite of being successful. That somebody is going to take over them. They will have plenty of wealth, plenty of name, plenty of fame, recognition, but still remain insecure because they will always feel somebody can overtake us one day. And it will happen. Whereas he takes plan B. If you do it with Samarpana Buddhi, a student excels finally and he leaves footprints in the society and he is remembered even before and after him. That is the difference which value, what is the difference value based education and non value based education can give? because both has marks, both has qualifications, both has recruitment policies, both has set standards to progress. But the difference is, a person with a value-based education will leave footprints. It is difficult to substitute him. That's the difference. And therefore Krishna says, you should impart education in this manner. Five more minutes, my 1 hour is over. Then take some questions. Now, if you do this, what will the child finally learn? We have not dealt the concept, we have also dealt the process. And we have defined the end point, nobility and humility. But what will the child in the journey acquire? It's, they say, a value-based education helps a child to understand the difference between love and hatred. See, why do they say so? What are we doing today? We are very circumstantial. We understand world works in a particular way. World is cynical. So we should prepare the child to be cynical. Only then it can meet challenges. This is exactly what we are doing. And what does the child therefore inherit? It thinks world is cynical. So these are the ground rules for handling cynicism. Whereas what does Krishna say? Teach the rules of life first. Then allow the child to take a call in a situation of cynicism. How should it confront that cynicism situation? That's a choice which the freedom should give to the child. You don't draw the rule at all, and you draw the rule to be how to handle a life of cynicism. Then that's not the rules of the game. Then the child will only believe hatred is the only way to achieve success. And it will not be peaceful. See, I think we have spent enough time by the Acharya. We travel a lot, we meet a lot of people, high places. Ultimately, Sandoshmavi illanga nariya per. People are not happy because their lives are not supported based on values. Simple. Very, very simple. So it's on life support system, and in ventilator they survive their lives. That's the truth. So, what is the difference? What does the child learn if you teach values? It learns the difference between love and hatred, between contentment and greed, between inspiration and perspiration, non-comparison trap and jealousy, transparency and privacy, self-confidence and arrogance, happiness and sorrow, joy and depression, empowerment and education, forgiveness and being vindictive. We can talk about each one of them for a few hours. There is so much material available in our literature, in our philosophy, in our scriptures, in our stories, in our epics, in our value system. Each one we can deal it for hours. But this is the quintessence. By imparting value, impart all this to a child. All of you are already doing it in a big way. But this 1 hour I spent only to just redraw the map in a style which is more adaptable to a modern thinking way. I have not done, see one thing very clear, I have not created anything from my own. I had the help of Sheila Rajendran, I had the help of Dr. Vaidya, I had the help of Shomla Ramchandran, I had the help of my wife, I had the help of two few other teachers, and we surfed a lot of material in the internet. All this we collated and then formed. So there's nothing new, creative, nothing. It's all there. We just processed it. And we felt that it is such an important gathering. So many teachers with passion. Imagine the institution with 60 years of strength celebrating its golden jubilee. And therefore, we should possibly deliver what little we know in the best possible way. And this is the essence of value-based education. We can take each ingredient and do a saptaham. It is that voluminous. Let me conclude by saying this. Let's make every child understand, ultimately, happiness comes to those who share happiness of others. Success comes to those who celebrate the success of others. By lighting one candle, that candle is capable of lighting 10 other candles without destroying itself. That's the beauty of a teacher. A teacher is one who erases darkness, leads light, dimension, or a perspective with great hope, fond hopes in the heart of a child. Then you become a noble teacher, you become a humble teacher, and you will remain as an eternal example in the heart of that child. Thank you once again for this great opportunity to speak.
Thank you, sir. You have indeed lit many a candle today. You have reinforced the anchors of our life. Everything happens because of God, the importance of family as an institution, and the need to nurture children to grow up to be noble and humble, leaving footprints. Thank you again. In pan-Indian tradition, a guru is more than a teacher who dispels darkness, leads towards light, a reverential figure who serves as a counselor, who helps mold values, shares experiential knowledge, an inspirational source, and a visionary icon. I request you, ma'am, embodiment of the qualities of an Acharya, to serve us the dessert after the treat.
Sir, your speech has inspired me to reach greater heights and learn from the past. I only have to tell you one example for what I learned from my mother, and I'm sure all of us will do that too. Our cook was working in a house with two children, and her husband suddenly passed away. You know our conditions. If your husband is dead, your widow, you can't go out of the house, you can't work and all that. My mother insisted that if we do that, that woman will be destroyed. Her children will go to dogs. You can't do anything. Take a bold step. And she persuaded her husband to go to Kanchi, where that woman was living, and she wouldn't be able to move. Pick her up in the car, brought her home, and made her the cook of the house and helped all the children. She had two girls. Mother asked me to use my influence to admit the children in Abhay home. And after that, they studied, in a humble way, but they studied well. And today that girl worked in a good office, like TTK's. She educated her children, and all of them are doing well now, and they are earning, and they are doing well. And that lady who was first encouraged by my mother lived a good life and served everybody and taught us how compassion and service is what matters. It's not the customs which are likely to ruin your condition of that woman. I'm so happy I followed her, and I'm sure all our teachers are following that, showing more compassion than condemnation, I would say, when a child is going down in his studies. How can you help him? That's what matters. And give him unconditional love and help. And our teachers are all doing that. They are being very first, they have compassion and no conditions. We see to it, they somehow study. There are teachers who sacrifice their evenings, their homes. They take the children home and educate them and see that they pass. And I think that is what is important. As you said, it is the compassion to the condition which we keep in front of us, the values, unconditional love. I do hope all our teachers will learn from the number of points you raised for us, and we'll all be good teachers, useful teachers, and compassionate teachers. Thank you so much for sparing your time and giving us your hallelujah.
I consider it an honor, more than that, a blessing to be sitting by the side of Dr. YGP. I say somebody who has spent 60 years of her life, and the kind of students they have brought, the kind of students where they live in high places, you are very inspiring at this age to me.
Thank you, ma'am. We definitely remember your words.
Thank you, my English teacher. In fact, you should have stopped with the dessert, and maybe you added more to it and said, I'm going to enrich the dessert. But rather, I will take this task as being a driver to drive all these people after the feast with some take-home message. So that way I will maybe make a very honest attempt. I might fail in that as well, to summarize what Mr. Venkataraman has articulated so well in the last 1 hour. So I'm asked to speak for 5 minutes. It's good to always give a time limit for teachers like us. So you started off your speech and clearly rationed the time accordingly, identifying various buckets, and spent a substantive part on the most important one, which is the value-based education. Of course, with a genuine sort of an apology to the committee of teachers here for encroaching their vacation time, because it's a time for you to get back. In fact, this morning, one of the parents called me and said, you are going to Padma Seshadri. Why don't you ask Mrs. Sheila Rajendra why she had the last examination on a Saturday? And no, but I defended you, don't worry. We all planned our vacation, and all of a sudden, you have the exam on Saturday. So I said rains, but at the same time I asked the parent the question, why is it you always have to have a vacation every quarter? When I was a student, my parents used to take me for vacation, and we call it only the summer vacation, and there was never another vacation for a calendar year, and now there is vacation for everything. So I said, you better plan your vacation properly and let it be the summer vacation, because you don't know what the teachers are going to do during the vacation. They are not away for different places, you said very clearly, answer papers and all that. And to top it, today also, you know, you never know, the National Human Rights Commission will come and ask you, you know, why did you fail this student, why not so many marks to that student? So there are a lot of issues. So they are also sacrificing the vacation. And you also started off with the Finnish example, Finland as a model education, and you were rightly articulated that it's impossible to generalize that model into a country like ours, which is very diverse. Because Finland, maybe all the alumni of Padma Seshadri put together will be the population of Finland. So, And it's easy to experiment that. And if at all you're planning to go for a vacation and take an early morning jog, make sure you don't run too much. Otherwise, you'll step into Sweden or Denmark. So that's the size of the country also. So it's very difficult to generalize that. And then you went on to give a very brief introduction on the existence of God, which anyway doesn't need a summary because you cannot summarize that. Then went on to talk about the institution called family. Of course, I fully agree with you that it is an institution that needs to be strengthened and enriched. It's very difficult to generalize trivialities that are happening outside into this institution of marriage. And it's in fact, you rightly pointed those examples of how a relationship happens between a husband and wife. And I don't know whether I have shared this with you before, but I usually share this talking about relationships because in a case of a different couple that was spending their 25th wedding anniversary, the husband was actually in tears. So the wife was so moved. So the wife went and asked, "I'm so happy that at the 25th wedding anniversary, you're shedding these emotional tears of joy." Then the husband says, "Don't be mistaken. These are not tears of joy. Remember, 25 years back, your father was a judge, and he caught both of us in a compromising position and then gave two options. You go to jail for 25 years, or you marry my daughter. Now I realize, you know, I should have taken the first option." So, I realize I have made a mistake. So, but that's not the type of relationship that we have to build in this holy institution of marriage. It has to be an endured relationship. And then to the question of values, which is very important, and that's where you spent most of the time. I recall Swami Dayananda Saraswati. He used to say, we had a two-day workshop for teachers. In fact, some of the teachers from PSBB also came. I think that was 7-8 years back. He defined the word value itself. He said, a value is a value if the value of value is valuable to oneself. So you have to know what is value, and to know that, you have to consider the value of that value to be valuable for yourself, and only then you will be able to appreciate the value. Otherwise, you will end up having a very distorted perception of value. And this again, I quote with an example. You know, a son in the family comes home crying and tells the mother, "Look, this morning, my father and I, we were traveling in the bus, and he gave me a tight slap, and I'm crying." And the mother asks, "What did you do?" "No, he asked me to offer a seat for a passenger, a woman passenger, and I failed to do that. I refused to do it." And she said, "No, it's basic value that if an elderly woman passenger is standing in a bus, you will have to offer your seat." But then the son says, "No, actually I was sitting on the dad's lap." So that was the problem. So when you have a very distorted perspective of what a value is, then it's very difficult to teach them what value is. So you have to consider that value to be very valuable, right? So this is how I would like to summarize the lecture that Mr. Venkataraman gave, because at the end of the day, it is about us being able to independently think, you know, accumulate this type of a lecture, which is loaded with a lot of information from religion, from philosophy, from various other domains. So let me then conclude with a philosophical, again, takeaway. You've quoted instances from the Mahabharata, so let me also conclude with Bhagavad Gita, because that's the take-home message. As teachers, you are all empowered to take action. But the problem today, especially in this ecosystem, is that we are not able to have a free mind before we exercise the freedom that we have to act. So your empowerment to act must be preceded by the capacity to have a free mind. And that's the essence of Bhagavad Gita. In fact, in a conference on Bhagavad Gita, everybody was talking about the literative text of Bhagavad Gita. And one of my friends was also asked to talk on this, but he was not an exponent in the text. So he said, I'm going to talk on the context of Bhagavad Gita. The context of Bhagavad Gita was that it was a dialogue between Lord Krishna and Arjuna. And Arjuna was loaded with so many confusions in his mind, and the entire Bhagavad Gita was an attempt to remove all those confusions and tell Arjuna, now it's time for you to fight the war. And that's how all the 18 chapters go. And in the 18th chapter, the 63rd sloka only, Lord Krishna says, Etat Ichchesu Tata Kuru Arjuna. In fact, many would ask this jokingly, if he had said this sloka in the first chapter, Bhagavad Gita would have been shorter. But he waited for the 63rd sloka, the 18th chapter. The message is this: all the slokas so far I have told you has removed all the doubts that you had in your mind, and now your mind is free. Only a free mind can exercise good action when it comes to exercising the freedom to act. So I hope this lecture by Mr. Venkataraman has given you that freeness in your mind, and as you move forward, you exercise your freedom to act in a very responsible way. Thank you very much.
I must first express my great happiness and gratitude to Mr. Venkataraman for having acceded to our request and coming here. And I'm so happy that in the Diamond Jubilee year of the school that this event is happening, I was very particular that there should be a Diamond Jubilee special address which should happen in the school, and Mr. Venkataraman should do it, and Mrs. Sheila was so kind enough to accommodate it, and the event has happened. And a lot has been said about the key takeaways from the lecture, and Dr. Vaidya also summarized it. What I felt about this issue and issues concerning psychology, which also sir touched about, because it's social psychology which is being shaped by relationships, is about impression management and the management of relationships. That is a core question. It's a very subjective theme, and it varies across facts, so it's not something which is common to everybody. But essentially, the teacher-student relationship is undergoing a tectonic shift, and it has to be managed within the accepted denominator of Indian culture is our concern. And this theme is a direction towards that. And more importantly, in our profession, in the legal profession, it's a privilege to brief a senior, to be associated with a senior, and that's something that we all look forward to. And it's very rare to see senior advocates of this stature who are so approachable when it comes to questions that concern society. After all, you know, lawyers or the legal profession is about social engineering as well. And here is an example of a social engineer who is doing it in the culture mandated fashion, which we all want. And it was such a wonderful talk, and I'm so happy that we were all able to make it. And during this very important year, the Diamond Jubilee year of the school coincides with the Ramanuja Sahasrabdi also. So it's a very auspicious time when this is happening. And let me thank Mr. Venkataraman once more, and wish Dr. Mrs. YGP the best of health, and look forward to the centenary, which is quite close. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Vaidya Subramaniam. Your address was real. It's an example of humor as an effective tool. And of course, Amrit Bhargav. May I now welcome Mrs. Geeta Govindarajan, Principal KK Nagar School, to propose the formal vote of thanks.
It is heartening to note that
There is so much solidarity of opinion among educators transcending generations. Expectations and requirements of children from teachers may vary according to the age, but what remains as an invariant is the unconditional love, as always our dean says that, and looking for strengths, glossing over weaknesses. Everyone who remembers his own education remembers teachers for some reason or the other. The teacher is the heart of the educational system. I would like to touch upon what sir said. Sir, I assure you that all of us will definitely spend few more minutes a day with students to impact them to create a fine human being, having faith in God, preserving family institutions with nobility and humility. We will urge them to practice satyam and dharmam to the possible extent. If whenever student fails to have the samarpana buddhi, I think we will attune ourselves to have the samarpana buddhi in order to align our goal. To Dr. Vaidya, he said, yata is the guru, tata is the shishyan. I am so proud that if my shishyan is so good, and probably every teacher, every single teacher who has taught him can feel really proud of that. And for Amrit, I really thank you for being instrumental in making the show a reality. For all of us, for students as well as for teachers, our school is an extended home, and our students feel us as the surrogated mothers. So I'm definitely assure you that this bonding of family bonding will be there, because we get children even after 40 years coming back to school to share their happy moments with us. And this special lecture has positively impacted more than 450 teachers. The cascading effect, we are sure, will be multifold. We are grateful to Mr. N. Venkataraman, Senior Advocate, Supreme Court, for investing time in guiding the molding hands. We are indebted to our beloved Dean and Director, Dr. Mrs. YGP, for inspiring us to be a lifelong learners. We are thankful to the special invitees, trustees, management committee members for their encouragement. Our thanks are due to the PTA and alumni present here for supporting the cause of learning. I wish to thank the heads and staff of PSBB schools for the wonderful cooperation. We are grateful to God for being with us as always. Om Shanti, Shanti, Shanti.
Let's now rise for the national anthem.
Adhinayak Jaya He Bharat Bhagya Vidhata Punjab Sindh Gujarat Maratha Dravida Utkala Vanga Vindhya Himachala Yamuna Ganga Uchala Jaladhitaranga Tava Shubha Name Jage Tava Shubha Ashish Mage Gahe Tava Jaya Gatha Jana Gana Mangala Dayaka Jaya He Bharata Bhagya Vidhata Jaya He Jaya He Jaya He Jaya 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 He
Thank you, teachers. On behalf of all of us, I wish you a very happy holiday and a happy new year. Bye.